Chapter 6, Financial Markets 2. Learning objectives. Understand the difference between nominal and real interest rates. Understand the role of risk premia. Understand the role of financial intermediaries. Know the extended ISLM model. Understand how the housing problem led to the financial crisis. Chapter 6 Outline, Financial Markets 2. 6-1, Nominal versus Real Interest Rates. 6-2, Risk and Risk Premia. 6-3, The Role of Financial Intermediaries. 6-4, Extending the ISLM. 6-5, From a Housing Problem to a Financial Crisis. Until now, we assumed there were only two financial assets, money and bonds, and just one interest rate, the rate on bonds, determined by monetary policy. The financial system also plays a major role in the economy. This chapter looks more closely at the role of the financial system and its macroeconomic implications. 6-1, Nominal versus Real Interest Rates. Nominal interest rate is the interest rate in terms of dollars. Real interest rate is the interest rate in terms of a basket of goods. We must adjust the nominal interest rate to take into account expected inflation. Figure 6-1 shows the definition and derivation of the real interest rate. If you loan money today in terms of goods, say a cup of rice, then after 1 year, you get back a little over one cup of rice. Then the extra rice you got is the real return on your loan. One good today is after 1 year equal to 1 plus RT goods. To derive the formula for the real rate, start by considering you invested in one good by buying it for its price, PT. After a year, if the nominal interest rate is IT, then you have PT times 1 plus IT dollars. After 1 year, the price level will be PT plus 1. If we adjust the nominal return by dividing it by the new price level, we will get the real return or the real interest rate earned on the investment of buying one good for PT dollars. Equation 6.1, 6.2, and 6.3 help us in understanding the relationship between real interest rate, nominal interest rate, and expected inflation rate. If the nominal interest rate and expected inflation rate are not too large, a close approximation to equation 6.3 is given by equation 6.4, which says that real interest rate in year T is approximately equal to the nominal interest rate in year T minus the expected inflation rate over that year. When expected inflation equals zero, the nominal interest rate and the real interest rate are equal. Because expected inflation is typically positive, the real interest rate is typically lower than the nominal interest rate. For a given nominal interest rate, the higher expected inflation, the lower the real interest rate. The real interest rate, I minus pi E, is based on expected inflation, so it is sometimes called the ex ante, before the fact real interest rate. The realized real interest rate, I minus pi, is called the ex post, after the fact interest rate. The interest rate that enters the IS relation is the real interest rate. The zero lower bound of the nominal interest rate implies that the real interest rate cannot be lower than the negative of inflation. Figure 6-2 shows nominal and real 1 year T-bill rates in the United States since 1978. The nominal interest rate has declined considerably since the early 1980s, but because expected inflation has declined as well, the real rate has declined much less than the nominal rate. 6-2, risk and risk premia. Some bonds are risky, so bondholders require a risk premium. Risk premia are determined by the probability of default, the degree of risk aversion of bondholders. Figure 6-3 shows yields on 10-year U.S. government treasury, AAA and BBB corporate bonds since 2000. It illustrates the impact of risk premia on the interest rates at which different organizations could borrow. In September 2008, the financial crisis led to a sharp increase in the rates at which firms could borrow. 6-3, the role of financial intermediaries. Until now, we have looked at direct finance, borrowing directly by the ultimate borrowers from the ultimate lenders. In fact, much of the borrowing and lending takes place through financial intermediaries, financial institutions that receive funds from investors and then lend these funds to others. Figure 6-4 shows a sample commercial bank's assets, capital, and liabilities. The bank has assets equal to $100. These could be cash, reserves in the bank's vault or deposits at the Fed, U.S. Treasury bills, loans to people or firms such as mortgages or business loans or student loans or loans to other banks. Assets could be more complex, such as mortgage-backed securities, which are essentially packages of different kinds of mortgages bundled together. These assets are less liquid than U.S. Treasury bills. They would be harder to sell in case the bank needed to raise cash quickly. Bank has liabilities equal to $80. These may be demand deposits that customers hold or money that the bank has borrowed from other banks. Capital is the difference between assets and liabilities. This bank has capital equal to $20. If liabilities become greater than assets, the bank would be insolvent. Capital ratio. The ratio of capital to assets equals 20 over 100 equals 20%. Leverage ratio. The ratio of assets to capital, 100 over 20 equals 5. A higher leverage ratio implies a higher expected profit rate, but also implies a higher risk of insolvency and bankruptcy. The lower the liquidity of bank assets means the more difficult they are to sell. The higher the risk of being sold at fire sale prices, prices far below the true value, and the risk that the bank becomes insolvent. The higher the liquidity of the liabilities, example, checkable or demand deposits, the higher the risk of fire sales and the risk that the bank becomes insolvent and thus faces bank runs. Focus: bank runs. The U.S. financial history up to the 1930s is full of bank runs, as seen in the classic movie It's a Wonderful Life. One potential solution to bank runs is narrow banking, which restricts banks from making loans and to hold liquid and safe government bonds. To limit bank runs, the United States introduced Federal Deposit Insurance in 1934. The Fed also implemented liquidity provision so that banks could borrow overnight from other financial institutions. 6-4, extending the ISLM. Now we extend the ISLM to reflect the distinction between 1. The nominal interest rate and the real interest rate, 2. The policy rate set by the central bank and the interest rates faced by borrowers. Note 1. The interest rate that enters the IS relation is the real interest rate given by the difference between the nominal interest rate I and the expected inflation rate pi E. 2. The interest rate that matters for borrowers is the real interest rate plus the risk premium X. The central bank chooses the real policy rate R. The interest rate faced by borrowers, which determines aggregate demand in the economy, is dependent on the expected inflation rate pi E and the risk premium X, which enter the IS relation. After the financial crisis, the role of risk premia has become evident. The central bank now chooses the real policy rate R, which enters the IS equation as part of the borrowing rate R plus X for consumers and firms. Equation 6.5 shows the IS relation with investment being dependent on Y and R plus X. Equation 6.6 shows the new LM relation in terms of the real interest rate. Figure 6-5 shows the effect of financial shock on equilibrium output. Increase in X, risk premium, leads to a shift of the IS curve to the left from IS to IS prime and a decrease in equilibrium output from Y to Y prime. Figure 6-6 shows how monetary policy can be used to counter the effects of an increase in the risk premium. If sufficiently large, a decrease in the policy rate can in principle offset the effect of an increase in the risk premium. The zero lower bound may, however, put a limit on a decrease in the real policy rate. 6-5, from a housing problem to a financial crisis. Figure 6-7 shows the behavior of US housing prices since 2000. The increase in housing prices from 2000 to 2006 was followed by a sharp decline thereafter. The 2000s were a period of unusually low interest rates, which stimulated housing demand. Mortgage lenders were increasingly willing to make loans to risky borrowers with subprime mortgages or subprimes. From 2006 on, many home mortgages went underwater when the value of the mortgage exceeded the value of the house. Lenders faced large losses as many borrowers defaulted. Banks were highly leveraged because banks probably underestimated the risk. Bank managers had incentives to go for high expected returns without fully taking the risk of bankruptcy into account. Banks avoided financial regulations with structured investment vehicles, SIVs. Banks created new products through securitization, which is the creation of securities based on a bundle of assets such as mortgage-based securities, MBS. Senior securities have first claims on the return from the bundle of assets. Junior securities, such as collateralized debt obligations, CDOs, come after. Securitization was a way of diversifying risk, but it came with costs. The bank that sold the mortgage had few incentives to keep the risk low. Even for toxic assets, the risk is difficult for rating agencies to assess. Wholesale funding is a process in which banks rely on borrowing from other banks or investors to finance the purchase of their assets. In 2000s, SIVs were entirely funded through wholesale funding. Wholesale funding resulted in liquid liabilities. Figure 6-8 shows US consumer and business confidence 2007 to 2011. The financial crisis led to a sharp drop in consumer and business confidence from 2007 to 2009, which in turn affected output. It bottomed in early 2009. The demand for goods decreased due to the high cost of borrowing, lower stock prices, and lower confidence. The IS curve shifted to the left. Policymakers responded to this large decrease in demand with financial policies, monetary policy, and fiscal policy. Financial policies. Federal deposit insurance was raised from $100,000 to $250,000. The Fed provided widespread liquidity to the financial system through liquidity facilities and increased the number of assets that could serve as collateral. The government introduced the Troubled Asset Relief Program, TARP. Monetary policy. The federal funds rate was down to zero by December 2008. The Fed also used unconventional monetary policy, which involved buying other assets as to directly affect the rate faced by borrowers. Fiscal policy. The American Recovery and Reinvestment Act was passed in February 2009, calling for $780 billion in tax reductions and spending increases. Figure 6-9 shows the impact of the financial crisis and the use of financial, fiscal, and monetary policies to stabilize the economy. The financial crisis led to a shift of the IS curve to the left from IS to IS prime. Economy moved from point A to B. Financial and fiscal policies led to some shift back of the IS curve to the right from IS prime to IS double prime. Monetary policy led to a shift of the LM curve down from LM to LM prime. Economy moved from point B to A prime. Policies were not enough, however, to avoid a major recession. Economy went from point A before the recession to point B as a result of the financial crisis. Expansionary fiscal and monetary policies, along with financial measures, moved the economy to point A prime, where output Y prime is smaller than the output Y at point A before the crisis.